as we already discussed, certain characteristics of sovereign power according to Michel Foucault. And then it appears that we were at the threshold of discussing what it was. Modern power, which has been characterized by the spread of the disciplines and so on and so forth. And it is actually, so to speak, impacts on the modern penal system, so that the transformation from the pre-modern, if you like, penal system into the modern penal system has been seen by Michel Foucault as the function of a transformation of the regime of power, when it goes to the regime of power. Actually, the regime of power is an interesting term, simply put.
How do you interpret that term? What do you understand when I say, when Michel Foucault says, a regime of power?
There is a sovereign which realizes its power to a lesser point.
Yeah, this was one of the actually regimes of power Foucault was talking about, that sovereign power. But the characteristic conceptualization of power, perhaps only peculiar to that book, simply because if we would have time, we will see that later on Foucault would make some modifications in this conceptualization of power. Coming a little bit closer to, if you like to say so, a little bit closer to our well-established traditional understanding of power. Here, power emerge as if something self-operating, self-existing something, okay? We would have some certain difficulties in calling it an entity. Rather, perhaps, we would refer to it by the term a process, okay? Emerging only in a confrontational situation among the ordinary people mostly, okay? So when we talk about regime of power, actually we are not talking about the regime of government or the political organization of the political institutions, so on and so forth, okay? What we are talking about when we say regime of power, at least within the context of that book, okay, is the more or less established relationalities of all those confrontations with each other, okay? All those tiny, little, minute confrontations taking place among the individuals in a society, okay, all do not are not taking place in a vacuum, okay? They are turn out to be somehow related with each other, okay? And that whole composed of their being related, all these power relations actually, I mean, okay, their being related with each other constitutes a certain regime of power. So the crucial point is that nobody, not a certain subject owns that power, or if you like, controls that power, or if you like, yields that power, okay? So the exercise of power at the minute, it shows itself, it has been already exercised, actually, okay? So nobody is there to exercise that power, okay? Disciplinary power is one peculiar example of the this new form of power regime, the modern power regime, so to speak. And actually, as you can see, both the agencies, you call them agencies perhaps, the agencies who appear to exercise power on the one hand, and let me remind you that Foucault will later on modify such a conceptualization of power and introduce the concept of the notion of agency or subject in connection with this notion of power. But for the time being, within the limits of that book, Discipline and Punish, okay, we can say that this situation is something like that. We are talking about the power actually which objectifies everything in a given certain field, okay? And objectifies and which exercises itself at the moment of its coming into being or production, if you like, at the moment of its appearance, already exercising itself, okay? And The interesting point, of course, is that actually this argument will come at a later book called The History of Sexuality, Volume 1, okay? Just a year later, Foucault published that book, okay? As far as I remember, the publication date of The Discipline and Punishment being 1975, and History of Sexuality, Volume 1 was published in 1976, okay? Just 1 year later, this second volume appears here, okay? So it can be considered rather as a part, an appendix of that Discipline and Punish, okay, that earlier book, rather than as the first volume of what Foucault would later on write and publish in 1982 and 84, the other two volumes of his History of Sexuality, okay, volume 2 and 3. So I am talking about power, a certain specific conceptualization of power within these limits, okay? So we would refrain from extending that conception to other later works of Michel Foucault. Okay, so it's limited to these two primary works where he talks about power as something subjectifying or producing subjectivities. In an interesting argument in connection with a critique of what he called the oppressive hypothesis. You know, usually speaking, we tend to understand power as something oppressive. What do you think? Especially within the context of that theory of action and that theory of power, derived from that theory action, you know, that theory of action, the author of the action having a telos here pertaining to itself, being triggered to act, so to speak, and realizing that telos here. Actually, that's why it's called the end of the action, okay? The end of the action is prior to action, okay? I'm aiming to do this, therefore I am acting in this or that direction, trying to realize that aim of the action, okay? So, right from this theory of action, actually we have seen that we had to presuppose the existence of an actor in a power relationship, okay? Acting in a power relationship onto somebody else, another person, okay? And actually, not only another person, if that A, the first person, acts on the other person, on the physical or biological being of the other person, what we are talking about is rather force, physical force or something like that, okay? Therefore, the power relationship, in this power relationship, the action of the A, the first person, is not on the person or whatever body of the other second person, but rather on the will of the second person, okay? So the will, the telos that the first person has, okay, has been carried over through this power relationship to the will of the second person, making that second person to accept first person's will as his own will, okay? This was the classical theory, and as you can see, there here we have the model of a relationship between a subject and an object, okay? Or two subjects, one of which being reduced to the status of an object, as Hegel discussed in his master and servant dialect. Okay, the one being here losing its own will, so to speak, okay, to the benefit of the first person's will, okay, so that the second person turns out to be the target of such an exercise of power, or the will of second person becomes the target of such an exercise of power. However, here in Foucauldian analysis, in these two works, okay, as we have seen, it was nobody that generated, that caused not certain structure of, so to speak, modular structure of power, a state or something like that, or head of the state. For instance, it was not the sovereign which was responsible for the establishment of that regime of power to which Foucault refers as the sovereign power, okay? The interesting point was that it was that particular regime of power at the one and same time while producing the sovereign on the one hand and producing the subjects on the other. Okay, so the responsible party was not the sovereign himself. So the relationship between the sovereign and the subjects cannot be established within such a framework, such a traditional framework of a certain conceptualization of power. Okay, so it was not the sovereign, okay, but rather the constellation of the power relations prevalent in the society, at the same time producing sovereign, at the same time producing the penal institution of torture as the basic institution of that society. Okay. Foucault's rejection of this grounding of this transformation on the basis of increasing humanitarianism, increasing rationalization, increasing efforts to reform the penal system, etc., points to that direction. Okay, that it was not due to the conscious efforts that power has been constelled in such a specific regime in that part of the world at that certain period of time. Okay, but rather his analysis shows that the prevailing societal relationships among those ordinary individuals, how they or certain sections, certain segments, certain divisions within that whole called society or social formation, whatever you like, have been positioned in relation to each other and enter into confrontational relationships, coming across with each other, so to speak. Okay, when I say confrontation, you should not necessarily understand negative connotation. Okay, I'm not talking about necessarily negative hostile relationships. I am talking about any kind of relationship, including those relationships of friendship as well. Okay, bringing people together, okay, creating a situation and producing power there. Okay, this is what I am talking about. So it was this constellation of those power relationships generating all these forms, panel forms, the forms of sovereign and the rest. Okay, now this has been changing as we have talked about and giving way to another constellation of the forces. Okay, this time what was at stake is no longer the sovereign power but a specific strategy of power, if you like. Okay, a disciplinary form of power, now no longer targeting the body of the individual but rather targeting the individual as the unity of the body and soul. For what? For to ensure the functionality of the body. Okay, again, this time it's no longer the problem of destroying or making a show of the power of the sovereign in all those spectacles of atrocity or whatever they were. Okay, but rather driving something efficient, okay, out of the body of the individual, okay, making that body of the individual, in other words, useful. And where useful, in what sense useful? Of course, according to the requirements of newly forming society, useful in production primarily. Okay, so that new power, when it's exercised, no longer aims at destroying the individual, okay? And it is widespread simply because it is economy established the fact that it is much more efficient than the earlier forms of power from an economical perspective, which means that it is much more easy to exercise it on the one hand, and on the other hand, it is much more cheaper, okay? In other words, economically feasible and desirable. Okay, it is much more cheaper and yielding, producing efficient results. Okay, one of the most important elements of this new disciplinary power was the timetable planning of the every detail of the movements of the individuals on the one hand, and on the other hand, ensuring the internalization of these certain movements, okay, as to the point that the performance of them would no longer require any thoughtful ingredients, okay, so that the individuals would perform those movements in a rather efficient way without even thinking about them, okay. And this has been ensured, so to speak, by repetitive exercise drilling, okay. So the continuity, you know, the exercise of the sovereign power was a matter of interruptions. Therefore, it needed, okay, it needed that public spectacle, okay, to engrave itself, its atrocity, through its atrocity on the minds of the individuals watching the event, okay. Here there are no such necessities, okay. What is only required is continuity of the exercise of power, a continuous exercise of power, continuously repeating the same procedures of acting, okay, the same movements. But the interesting point is that now we have arrived in our analysis of power at a certain point where power no longer aims at crushing the individual, but through its operations, actually and exactly producing the individual, making what the individual is in this new society, okay? Making the individual a certain functionary in this society. That was important. While at the one hand, it has a very function of taming the individual, making the individual docile through all those normalizing processes on the one hand. On the other hand, it actually creates the individual, okay? Produces the individual. That was an important, actually, contribution to the discussions of power. And that was the reason why Foucault, in his later book especially, the first volume of History of Sexuality, come to reject that oppressive hypothesis of power. You know, according to oppressive hypothesis, which is quite commonplace, okay, power oppresses, okay? Yeah, and when I talk about, within that traditional framework, when I talk about power, this is usually in the tone of a complaint, okay? Understanding, showing a certain understanding of power as a restrictive power, okay? As an individual, as a social group, I am willing to achieve a certain this or that, okay? While confronting with power, the effect of that power within the structure of its relationship with me is to oppress, okay, is to take me away from my direction, from my telos, okay, to render me as to the point of rendering me being unable to realize my telos, okay. For instance, a Marxist theory, a Marxist interpretation of power, actually, and in that book, Foucault primarily targets the leftist understanding of power, okay? Leftist understanding of power as the instrument or as the very operation itself, okay? Now, I'm gonna leave it up to you, actually, to decide which one was right, but I'm sure that Foucault was right when he was pointing, at least understood in terms of another aspect of power, okay, that power actually, especially that new modern form of power, is indeed creates rather than destroys, okay. Actually, it creates, or if you like, produces what we are, okay. It's now widespread in the society. Its occurrence or its show off is no longer in the form of an infrequent show off, etc. Okay, it's everywhere in each and every relationship we enter with the others, okay. We in school system we encounter or being subject to the exercise of such power. In military, we are being subject to the exercise of power, such power. In our penal system, we are being subject to the exercise of power. In our work process, in our production processes, we are being subject to the exercise of power. And indeed, as we have seen, Foucault sees the very origin of this new main form of punishment in modern societies as the workhouses, okay? actually workhouses designed for production, places designed for production, or in connection with production. Now, what's at stake was the transformation of these workhouses, which had been originally established to be able to put all those dangerous elements to work, to be able to cure their soul, okay? Cure their soul. So aimed at production in, as a response to the problems of production that institution had been developed or originated. But it is development now assumes a new form as places of incarceration, as places where you can put all those dangerous elements together apart from the society and exercise a control over their lives, control over their lifespan, so to speak, and through the enforcement of the work onto the daily practice of those individuals, you ensure a certain grip, to acquire a certain grip on their souls at the same time, okay? No longer simply the body is the what's at stake. What's at stake rather is the totality of the individual as the unity of the body and soul. Now, the earlier individual under the sovereign rule would could easily be saying that, yeah, okay, you can control my body and my soul, it will always be mine, okay, this time, what's at stake here? We are turned out to be belonging to the power or in finding ourselves in the field of the exercise of power, body and soul together, okay? Now, we have seen that this assumed a form of surveillance at the same time as to ensure and increase the efficiency, effectivity of that power as well, and reducing further, causing or leading to further reduction of the cost, simply because the process of surveillance, once established, would no longer require the actual real existence of the big eye to watch over you, okay? Once you are convinced that you are under surveillance, you begin to act accordingly, okay? No longer in your own self, but always feeling yourself under the control, under the observing eye of the power, okay? This, therefore, Foucault would call, assume a form of biopower, okay? Now this time, the reason he calls this biopower being that this new form of power turns out to be, in his terms, life-giving, life-flourishing power rather than being a destructive power. Actually, a closer analysis could easily show you that it is through the through being subjected to the exercises of such power, the modern individual comes to be what it is. Okay, for instance, through all those educational procedures during which you have been subject to the exercise of such disciplinary power, you turn out to be individuals capable of performing certain tasks in the society. Huh? Okay. You turn out to be individuals capable of understanding gender differences, for instance, okay? Turn out to be individuals capable of reading and writing, engaging in intellectual discussions, so on and so forth, okay? All these qualifications actually making you what you are, okay, in this new society. Okay, so therefore, from the perspective of an individual, for instance, finding him or herself in the bosom of the modern society and under the exercise of such disciplinary power, there would be no reason to try to escape from its exercise, such an exercise. Okay? It makes you what you are. Okay? It gives you, in Foucauldian terms, it gives you life, your own life. Okay? It makes you the individuals, if you wish, with all your own uniqueness, okay? So, This argument Foucault counterposes against the argument of a conceptualization of power which conceives it as an oppressive process. Now, again, we are still maintaining that dual meaning of the concept of subject, okay, as the subject in its ordinary sense. So far we have discussed it, okay, the subject capable of being the center locus of a given action, okay, through its capacities of having a reason and free will on the one hand, and on the other hand, and I'm talking about modern subjectivity, and on the other hand, the other aspect of the subject, being subjugated to the exercise of power, okay. Now, when I mingle these two, the result would be interesting, okay. It is through being subject to the exercises of power, the individuals come to be a subject having the capacities of rational thinking and free will, which turns out to be the interesting result here, okay. Okay, what else can I say? Therefore, this began to be called somewhere at the last quarter of the book, Discipline and Punish. Foucault gradually begins to call this, or introduces his concept of biopower, not yet to be carried over to a framework of a concept, but in connection with this life-giving capacity of power, okay, life-giving and controlling capacity of this new form of power. Okay, so this is why it's called biopower. Okay, it is about life, and it is about the constitution of the very life, the constitution of the very possibility of life. Okay, and it appears that if we follow the arguments developed in these two books, we'll find out that it is through the being subject to the exercise of this power that the individuals come to be able to live in this modern society. Okay, so what do you think about this? How should we approach the question of power? Is there anything right in that oppressive hypothesis of power, or what Foucault says about this so far, okay, cancels out, eliminates any validity on the part of that oppressive hypothesis? What do you think about this? Come on. For instance, I am talking about that power relationship now between you and me taking place in this situation. I as instructor talking in a rather loud fashion, and you as students preferring to keep your silence. What kind of relation is this? Does it have any oppressive quality, for instance?
Productive olmadığı kesin.
It's not productive, she says. Okay. Are we really thinking so, that this course is not productive? You're sitting here and I'm talking here.
Sessizliğimiz productive.
Okay. It produces something else. It may not produce perhaps meanings within the context of that theoretical discussion, but apart from that, in another context, it produces, capable of producing many, lots of meanings. So what do you say about this? For instance, as sociologists, if I asked you to analyze the situation in this classroom, what kind of things you'd like to say? This could be an exam question, actually.
Maybe.
Why not?
If you speak, we see that we know nothing. This maybe show us our qualifications. yani bize ne olduğumuzu gösteriyor olabilir. Hani bağlamaya
çalışıyorum. Are you sure that you know nothing?
Yani nothing değil ama yani nereye bilmediğimizi görüyoruz.
If you ask me, you know a lot, more than you think.
Yeah, it shows that we have a reluctance to answer some questions that you ask. But this reluctance is due to us being afraid of being wrong or saying something wrong.
Okay, so saying something wrong. What do you expect as an answer to this wrongly said something? As a response to this wrong? A wrong committed by you in front of me and in front of the others in the class. A crime deserving to be punished. Well, no longer. This new form of power does not aim to punish. It aims to increase productivity. Okay? Therefore, it does not intend to destroy the bodies, destroy the students. It does not intend to crush them down. But rather, it intends to make them something useful. Is it really so? And what this power is? Under whose control? Is it under my control? Just like the processes which put you here, some other or similar processes put me here as well, together with you. So is it me or you or your families or who? Who operates this biopower? Who wants us to be observed all the time? Is it the government? Or our own very selves? Could it be possible? Could it be possible that it's we us who demand to be watched all the time? And maybe our primary point of suffering being that perhaps we are not worth to be watched all the time. It's we ourselves that produce that demand to be watched, it appears, huh? Why, we have lots of excuses. The demand for security, for instance. The demand for security is nothing else than the demand for a power superior than yours. Huh? So that's the reason we are sitting there in silence, simply because the loudspeaking, the existence of the loudspeaking instructor ensures that we sit over there in our security. So this is anyway how Foucault opens up in his discussion of power. This new power began to be talked about much later on. Okay? Now, but this was up until 1976. Okay? In the following couple of years, it appears that from other speeches, interviews, etc., Foucault changed his position in a rather radical way, at least for those who accept that Foucault, especially in the earlier works, okay, would have some difficulty in understanding of the arguments developed later on, okay? Simply because, as we have seen, up until now, we have what we are seeing is an intentional exclusion of any possibility of subjectivity as the center of action, okay? The subject is over there, but as it produced something as a result of the exercises of power or processes of power. Okay, yeah, there is a subject over there, we ourselves, but not in the sense that we tend to think or we like to think about ourselves. Okay, we tend to think that a la Kant, okay, our subjectivities have been given to us by being humans. Okay. So, but we are coming to learn that our subjectivities is the product of the operations of power operating under a certain regime, under a certain constellation of relations and so on, okay? And answering to certain demands, demands coming from nobody actually, demands created by this interaction of the forces in a given society or social organization, whatever you like to call it, okay? There are the demands of production, there are the demands of trade, there are the demands of this or that, but these demands having nothing to do with our individual existences and so on. Okay, so we are being the target of these demands actually, and being tamed. He calls production of the docile bodies, for instance. He handles the problem of this new form of power as a problem of the production of the docile bodies. Docile, Türkçesi, evcilleştirilmiş, tamed, terbiye edilmiş. Hizaya getirilmiş, if you want. Bodies operating always through the, with the direction of a normalizing effect, okay? Producing a normalizing effect, aimed at the production of the normalizing effect, okay? So making us, in a way, as much as it is effective, all those normal individuals functioning properly according to the places which they have been distributed in the social organization of the space, social space, I mean, okay, social distribution of space, and so on, okay? But this ends with 1976, a new era, a completely different perspective in Foucault's theoretical thinking begins to develop, which he actually expresses in his interviews as well as in his lectures in Collège de France, and finally comes to the daylight in the publication of the second volume of History of Sexuality. Before passing to this, maybe we have to touch upon the question of sexuality a little bit, okay? But let me finish my statement, and culminates in the publication of third volume in 1984. But why? Okay, before that, why sexuality? Okay. Foucault finds that the operation of this new form of power, the production of sexuality turns out to be one crucial element, okay? But don't forget, it's not only one element, or not single element, or not the most important element, but an important element among possibly other elements, okay? So through the production of these sexualities, what I'm saying an interesting phrase, production of sexualities, what is it? Let's stop here. Let's not jump into the things. What kind of discourse is this, talking about the production of the sexualities? What, since when sexualities began to be produced? Huh? If we were talking about gender, for instance, rather than sexuality, our task would be quite easy, you know? Gender as a concept already refers to the social. But what about sexuality? What do you have anything to say about it? All those women folk here in this class having an interest in gender studies, so to speak. You should have something to say about this. Now I'm talking about the production of the sexualities rather than the production of social roles, understood within the concept of gender. What do you say? Do you have something to say about it? Or are you going to leave it to me as well? Well, I'm not a woman. I'm not going to defend women. Okay? Actually, if you are going to leave it to me, I'm going to rather launch an attack on femininity, for instance. What do you say? Are you going to develop a defense or another male?
Yeah, no, I'm going to talk about something else. Yeah, maybe it's the production of sexual perception, sexual norms, morals, codes?
No, no, the very sexuality. You are talking about that this guy is homosexual, that guy is heterosexual, that guy bisexual, etc. The very sexuality is production of the very sexuality. It's not only gender roles. The very sexualities themselves is at stake here in this discussion. So, any of you going to defend the concept gender here? You know, this course has been recorded, so are your instructors trying to teach you the concept of gender? May watch it. May watch your silence, okay? So last time I am asking. Sen yine bir şeylere hevesli gözüküyorsun.
Gender is different.
They are different, yes, they are different. That was an important contribution, thank you very much. Okay, no, nothing to say? Fine, all right, then let's have a break.